There's a new battery technology that could change everything for cities, and it rolls out as soon as December of 2025. As a permaculture urbanist, I'll walk you through what it is and why it's a game changer, how it poses a beautiful dilemma for cities, what's really at stake, and what cities need to do now to secure a long and prosperous future for everyone. Welcome to Edenicity. Best practices for sustainably abundant cities. Here's what happened. Chinese battery maker CATL announced that their new sodium-ion battery is going into production this December. In the same time frame, U.S. stealth battery startup Peak Energy completed operational tests of a sodium-ion grid storage battery, and they expect to enter full-scale production as early as 2028. And let me be clear, sodium-ion battery chemistry is an unexpected beast. Compared to lithium-ion batteries, CATL claims that it's now making cells for $19 a piece versus today's prices of $55 a piece for lithium-ion cells. And they expect that with volume production, they can get that down to as little as $10 per cell, as reported by Ben Alexander in a recent YouTube episode. For EV battery packs, which add a lot more hardware, this could bring the price down by 31 to 36%. But for grid storage, this could drop the prices conservatively by 50%, and I've run some numbers that suggest that it could drop as much as 87%. In the context of electric vehicles, we're looking at longer range. For example, swapping in the sodium ion for the old lithium ion batteries in new electric vehicles could increase a vehicle's range from, say, 800 kilometers to 1,000 kilometers between charges. And according to multiple sources, you might be able to cycle sodium batteries through three times as many charge cycles as a lithium ion battery, meaning that in electric vehicles, you wouldn't have to change the batteries for 60 years. There's essentially no fire risk to these batteries, and they can handle extreme temperatures from negative 40 degrees to 70 degrees Celsius. They have the same or better charge time, shelf life, and charging efficiency as lithium ion. Because they're basically replacing lithium with sodium, same group next period down in the periodic table, CATL claims that they can use current lithium ion battery production lines, which will speed it into production. And best yet, sodium is abundant. Unlike lithium, you can basically find it everywhere on Earth, from salt if nowhere else. So unlike the case for lithium, we're not going to run out of sodium anytime soon. And you'll see just how big a deal this is in a moment. But here's the dilemma for cities. Multiple manufacturers are taking this new chemistry and racing with it to make batteries a lot cheaper. This means that electric vehicles will be cheaper to build. And in a way, that's great because it speeds the transition from fossil fuels to clean energy. But it also speeds the way toward ever more cars and car infrastructure. And that's bad. Very bad for people and especially for life on Earth, as we'll see. But let's start with the good. And trigger warning, I'm about to talk about an Elon Musk company. Before he went crazy, Tesla's one and only mission was to speed the transition to renewable energy. And over the years, Tesla has made three master plans to achieve this. The first one in 2006 was really simple. Build a luxury electric vehicle, or EV, and use the money from that to build more affordable EVs. A decade later, when they were in mass production, the company went a little bit off the rails with an updated master plan that focused on full self-driving, self-earning EVs. And 9 years later, we're still waiting for that. Then a couple of years ago, they went all in with part three of the plan, which was to electrify the world with solar and wind power by 2050. They had a really detailed document, which I've linked below in the description. But for me, the big takeaway was that if we did nothing and just simply kept buying oil from now through 2050, it would cost the world $14 trillion to meet its energy needs. But if we electrified everything, put in all the wind power and solar power where it was needed, we could electrify the world for $10 trillion. The question they were posing to the world is, are you willing to transition to 100% renewable energy, even if it costs you less money? Well, I crunched the numbers, and sodium ion battery storage makes this transition even more of a no-brainer. With sodium ion battery storage, it's a near certainty that electrifying the world would cost us half as much as just simply doing nothing and just buying more oil. This is great news, right? It means that the world is much more likely to transition to renewable energy sooner rather than later. But there's a catch. In my last episode, I introduced the concept from permaculture that everything gardens. That is to say, every living being and every system that it sets up alters its environment to maintain itself. In this sense, we all garden. Well, Tesla is a car manufacturer, so it's going to garden cars. This means that every move it makes is going to increase the number of cars, roads, parking lots, and car service facilities in the world. And cheaper batteries will only speed this. Now, in case you haven't been watching a lot of permaculture and urbanist channels, here's why more car infrastructure is terrible for people and the planet. Compared to mass transit, cars cost at least 10 times more, which, as car prices keep rising, contributes significantly to inequality. Cars are also at least 50 times more dangerous than mass transit, and in the case of high-speed rail, such as Japan's Shinkansen trains, cars are hundreds to thousands of times more dangerous. Cars use 25 times as much material and energy per passenger, and they use 10 to 45 times more land than mass transit, which is why it doesn't take very many cars and their infrastructures to make a city seem crowded and noisy and create an incentive for that city to sprawl so that people can get away from it. But what can cities do about it? As I pointed out last time, animals and for the most part people garden to maintain the status quo. But because of our intelligence and our language, humans do have the capacity, rarely used, to imagine and mentally inhabit a much better future and garden toward that. And when we do this, it makes it much easier to choose an upgrade path that can heal the earth and provide energy equality. Now, let me break down what I mean by each of those. Now, if hedonicity made a master plan to heal the earth, it would use transit-oriented multifamily development to free up 80 to 96% of the land in cities. Then we could use a good chunk of that space, plus the rooftops, to grow food. In other words, choking traffic becomes gardens and orchards. And once we've done that, this frees large landscapes damaged by agriculture for wilderness restoration. And this is sorely needed because we live in a world where we've occupied half the land, and by removing the multiple layers of life, we've wiped out half the life. The second thing we want to accomplish is energy equality. As it stands right now, the world population is 24 times as big as the United States, but the world uses only 6 times as much energy as the United States, meaning the U.S. is using way, way more than its fair share of the energy in the world. Now, the world population is going to grow to about 27 times the projected growth of the U.S. by 2050. And if we aim for energy equality by 2050, then the world would consume 27 times the energy that the U.S. consumes then. Now, how would that look on the ground? Well, maybe a world where everyone in every neighborhood, in every city, has a good home and enough energy to thrive. Ideally, cities could also provide free transportation, healthcare, and education to everybody. Question is, how do we get there? That's not too many years in the future for a huge increase in the number of people enjoying the benefits of a high-energy civilization. Well, the hedonicity approach is to make cities 80% more energy efficient, and of course, to expand access to renewable energy worldwide. So let's look at what it takes to get to energy efficiency in cities in a way where we all thrive. First, we should build mixed-use, mixed-income, multifamily housing. As I've shown in a prior episode, this can use up to 96% less land and 77% less energy per household. And because everything's built closer together, it dramatically reduces the number of trips that people need to make by motorized transportation. But then we focus on public transportation, which itself uses about 96% less land, material, and energy than cars. And besides that, as I've shown in another prior episode, switching to mostly public transportation cuts the emergency room trauma load and chronic disease by some 90%, which contributes a lot toward having affordable health care. Finally, by creating permaculture landscapes, these are basically landscapes where there's layer upon layer of productive food and fiber plants, we end up restoring groundwater and enjoying fresh air, water, and food, as well as having far less waste because the food is traveling far less distance to get to us. And then when we've done these things, we add on-site renewable energy. And again, I've shown how to do this in previous episodes. All right, so that's how we make cities affordable and energy efficient. But can the world afford energy equality? In a word, yes, easily. The Tesla master plan didn't include it. In fact, both buying more oil and implementing the Tesla master plan only benefits about 2 billion people. And remember, they're not all in one country. It'll be the elite in all countries in the world. Or, and again, I've run some numbers on the spreadsheet for this, where we can spend a couple more trillion dollars than the Tesla plan, but $5 trillion less than just buying more oil, and bring everybody in the world up to energy equality on the hedonicity plan. Now, you might wonder how the battery companies align with this. Well, CATL is still mainly transportation-focused. They do have some public transit designs, so that's a good thing. But because the sun doesn't shine at night and the wind doesn't blow steadily all the time, we need to store a lot of energy. And CATL has spent about 5 years building a prototype grid storage facility. It is climate controlled, and systems like this may, according to 2-Bit DaVinci, still use exotic materials such as manganese, cobalt, and graphite, which can be in short supply and are from supply chains that China already dominates. But Peak Energy has chosen a completely different path. Their sodium iron pyrophosphate battery is built from the ground up for grid storage. It has no climate control, much simpler power management. Again, 2-Bit DaVinci went into this. There's a link in the description. Minimal or no fire suppression. That's huge. And their goal is to source all raw material from the U.S. And this should really be a goal for all the different regions in the world. China should definitely source from the supply chains that they control. The U.S. should develop its own. Europe should develop its own. Africa should as well. This is just a smart strategy. That said, the lithium in lithium-ion batteries is severely resource-constrained, as we'll see in a moment. And for countries like the U.S., we do import a lot of it, as you can see in the blue in this chart. The blue graph just shows you a time sequence of our imports of each element from 2004 to 2024. But as you can see, sodium, iron, and phosphorus are so abundant they haven't even been assessed. Ironically, the biggest constraint is carbon, which is one of the most common materials on Earth. It's found in all life on Earth, and especially all plant matter, living or fossilized. But as it happens, industrial carbon comes in many forms. Graphite, hard carbon, carbon black, which is the black pigment that protects tires from ultraviolet damage. And it's essential for the anodes in all of modern batteries, including the sodium-ion batteries. China has basically cornered the graphite market, but Peak Energy's design uses hard carbon, and hard carbon may be a little bit easier to synthesize, and in any case, there's many ways to make it, from methane to biomass. So though graphite and hard carbon are the scarcest of the materials in the sodium-ion battery, geological survey still estimates that there's 800 million tons of naturally occurring graphite that are easily recoverable worldwide. The question is, how long will our mineral resources last? Well, again, I ran a spreadsheet for the scarcest of the minerals, including, ironically, naturally occurring carbon. I plugged in their service life, how much of them can be recycled. We're getting better at recycling. How much is available right now to be mined, and how much we need for each of these chemistries. Here's what I came up with. For a world of 10 billion people living in energy equality at a high standard of living, so that anyone from the United States, Canada, Norway, or Denmark would choose it in a heartbeat, the lithium in lithium-ion batteries would only last 40 years before we're out of that resource. If we went with nickel in the Edison batteries that I talked about in an episode 5 months ago, we'd be looking at 250 years. But there's no longer any reason to do that at all, because with carbon-ion batteries, we're looking at nearly 2,000 years before we run out of the natural carbon resources, and probably many, many tens of thousands of years beyond that before we start running out of the other minerals. Okay, if a future of abundance for everyone that heals the Earth is something people want, then here are the two best things people can do to make it happen. First, lean in to mass transit. That means when your city is considering road expansions, say no to them. Say no to parking mandates when there's any new construction. Say no to detached houses, which can bring the density down so low that it makes transit much more expensive. And of course, say yes to mixed income, transit-oriented development. This frees up space for urban agriculture, and it makes life much more enjoyable and affordable. And the second thing they can do is to lean into renewables. That means if your city is growing and you're considering new fossil fuel contracts for your power generation, don't do it. Instead, say yes to on-site solar, wind, and hydropower, as well as grid storage batteries. Thanks so much, as always, to the wonderful patrons for supporting this work. I really appreciate it. And thank you especially for watching this and farming a better future in your mind. Take care, stay green, see you next time.